2 years ago to be like, hey, forget about all the stuff that just happened. Let's check out Johnny Depp's fucking horrible, you know, spousal abuse. Like, it's also sucks, but it's like the kind of like the way that like celebrity and stuff like this is used as kind of like a carrot to dangle to take people's eyes off the ball, to mix a lot of metaphors.
Yeah.
I think the Heidi Fleiss trial is a really good example of that. And she kept saying it like, hey, why are we focusing on this? LA has a lot of real issues we're not focusing on. The schools are about to be shut down because of lack of funding. Who fucking cares if a bunch of rich guys bought some hookers from consensually?
Well, I guess my last question for you is, have you talked to Heidi Fleiss? Is she aware of you and the show? Have you had any contact
with her personally? And I think I'm going to try to reach out for her for the finale. I was kind of like going to wait. I also just like, I didn't know what kind of shape the show would take when I started. And then when I just started getting into the research, I had this idea of like reconstructing it because she said so much stuff at the time, you know, because she's on the record constantly talking about how she feels about it in the moment. So I was like, I'm interested in how she feels now, but I'm also just interested in how she processed this insane thing that was happening to her when she was like 26 and suddenly the most famous woman in the world and having to be sort of the front, you know, the face of a lot of fucking issues that she didn't really want to even be the spokesperson for. Yeah. And just like where we're at now with all this stuff, where it feels like sex sells everything more than ever on the internet too. And she says this thing in an upcoming episode about, yeah, like when she gets out of jail, she's basically like, my, you know, the world I came from is over. Like madams don't need to exist anymore because now we have the internet, and the internet is the madam, basically, right? Like if you want to broker sex, like you could do it on Craigslist at that point. And now we're at a point where it's harder and harder for sex workers to do their jobs and to broker sex work online, which is the only place they can do it and, you know, have some degree of safety because of people like Peter Thiel being like, the banks don't want to take checks that, you know, are from sex workers. And it's like, well, you're taking checks for like, you know, war surveillance, which is objectively bad. Like, why, you know, why don't the banks want to admit that they're brokering sex work at the same time that obviously the whole fucking internet runs on sex? Like Instagram sells sex. And, you know, the reason that it's not decriminalized and the reason that it is marginalized in this way is so fucking guys like Mark Zuckerberg can collect all the profits.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, it's something you brought up in when Catherine interviewed you for Elle. And like, the question is, like, you know, like the sex trade, like leaving aside whether it should be legal or illegal or any like moral questions that anyone may have about this. Like, I think the point is, like, what it really comes down to is not about like whether it's legal or illegal or moral or immoral or ethical or not. The point is, the question always comes down to is who profits from it. And it does seem like if it's men profiting from selling women, that one way or the other, we look the other way. But it, like, that door only swings one way for the most part.
Yeah, 100%. And when she went to Pahrump, Nevada, outside Las Vegas. Dennis Hoff, episode 10 is really fun with all that stuff. But yeah, she inherited all these tropical birds from another madam in Las Vegas.
Stav's grandfather? No.
Nice.
I think they came from the Tropicana, and this other madam gave her, so she started this bird sanctuary, and she tried to open a brothel for women, and in libertarian,
she was trying to run on like a stud farm, right?
Yeah, she tried to open a stud
farm.
Men
who pleasure women, yeah.
With men who pleasure women for money, and Pahrump, libertarian Nevada, they said, we can't have that. That's too far.
Okay, wait, in the county where brothels are legal.
Oh, brothels are legal.
Yeah, yeah. They wouldn't let her open a brothel that catered to women.
They were literally like, it'll bring a bad element.
What?
Bachelorette parties?
You know, like, that's ethically over the line. Women can't pay for sex. It's a one-way transaction where men pay for sex.
Yeah, women. We cannot have this one county in Nevada turn into Nashville, Tennessee. I mean, we've just been there. We've seen the social anarchy that causes.
And then she got out of the sex work business entirely, and she has a laundromat called Dirty Laundry in Pahrump. Somebody told me she has a private airfield that she lets people fly in directly to Pahrump when they're going to the bunny ranch for sex, going to the legal brothels. she's a hustler. She's still making money in some way or another because she just is. Somebody compared her favorably to a cockroach. They were just like, she cannot be like destroyed. And that's like powerful. Because again, it's like the mainstream narrative about sex workers is like that it's always bad, right? That something fucking horrible always happens. They always die. They always become drug addicts. Like if you go into porn, it ruins your life. All these kind of cliches. And it's like, you know, there's a lot of sex workers that's like, obviously some people like do have bad stories, but it's like, people have bad stories in every industry. And yeah, this porn director said to me, she was like, there's abused women in every fucking industry on earth. You know, there's abused women in the most mundane industries, but it's only porn that people are like, everyone's abused. Everybody's so fucked up. Like they can't make their own choices. They wouldn't do this if they were like consciously choosing something.
Unlike the regular entertainment industry where, you know, everyone goes through that, comes out, you know, always like, you know, smelling like daisies and never traumatized again, or fucked over in any way.
Part of my larger theory is that like, yeah, the porn industry is not as exploitative as Hollywood because a lot more women are in charge of shit in the porn industry now. And like Hollywood, by and large, is still a huge boys club, even though it occasionally does like a little like front facing makeover to be like, hey, look, we're not racist and sexist anymore. But then again, it's like then something like the fucking Will Smith and Chris Rock thing happens where everyone just reveals that they're like a psycho liberal, like just wants Will Smith to go to jail now, you know, like that was also just crazy.
We also said like for the like, you know, the porn industry as it like, you know, as compared to Hollywood, would you say it's like for the men and women who are performers in the porn industry, probably like professionally, like have more of a choice over who they have sex with than a lot of the people who try to break into the entertainment industry or work in, you know, Hollywood or TV proper?
Well, I think it's just like there's no guarantee when you do casting couch stuff, because again, it's like, yeah, somebody might offer you like, maybe I'll give you a job if you have sex with me, but they won't necessarily give you the job. I think porn is just like people, it's like the exploitative things in porn are usually happening on screen consensually, and that just like makes people lose their minds in some weird way, you know? It's like if you talk to porn stars, and one of the big reasons I went to the AVN Awards is because there's like a famous David Foster Wallace article where he talks about it, where he goes and just observes everything, but it's like he doesn't talk to anybody. He just talks kind of, yeah, he doesn't talk to the porn stars. And I was like, I want to talk to the porn stars and see how the fuck they feel about it. You know, do they feel like they're being exploited? If they're telling you they don't, then like, why wouldn't you believe them? You know? And that's what happened with the Heidi Fleiss trial, too, is the girls were all like, I don't feel exploited. I'm doing this on purpose because it's better than waitressing. I'm making so much money. It's in a safe environment, mostly. And Heidi Fleiss is like taking like a managerial cut. Like when you talk to sex workers, they're like, yeah, we just want like a safe place to do our job. And also like they want their work to be acknowledged as just work like anything else, you know? I mean, that's the big thing, is that people think it's like, well, if you're having sex, it must be like for fun. It's like, no, it's their job. And their job is to make it seem like it's fun.
Okay, but before I close things out, Matt and Felix, do you have any final closing thoughts or questions for Molly?
When do you need my Tom Sizemore line pickup spot?
Oh, do you want to do those? Do you think you
could do those?
No,
I can definitely do those.
Just, if you could do them like this weekend, that would be great because they're for the episode 9 and I'd love to just like throw some more Tom Sizemore. They're just like really crazy too.
I can do them by then.
Okay, easily. Cool. That'd be awesome. Thank you.
No problem.
Yeah, aside from practical questions that we're still making the podcast, which is definitely 100% true. Yeah, it's just been fun. I mean, thanks for having me on to talk about it. I really appreciate it.
Our pleasure.
Well, I mean, we have been talking about celebrity and Hollywood, and I would be remiss if I wanted to end the show by, on a personal note, just like recognizing the passing of really one of the great American actors, Ray Liotta, died today or died last night. We've all found out about it today. Just God, Ray Liotta. Just like for me personally, like when I think about moments in my life that like changed it, or that like is like a moment of like diamond clarity of like when my life, like, you know, of like walking through a door. It was the first scene in Goodfellas when he slams shut the car trunk and the Tony Bennett rags to riches kicks in. Like a genuine moment that like opened up my mind. Like his performance as Henry Hill in Goodfellas was like a truly life-changing experience the first time I saw that movie that like really opened up my mind to the possibilities of what like film was capable of doing, and like really truly absolutely changed my life. Ray Liotta, just to his friends and family, I hope you know that like so many people like thought he was like, you know, a truly special talent. And it doesn't end with Goodfellas. I could go on about Something Wild, fucking Copland, No Escape. I'm probably gonna watch that tonight. I mean, Ray Liotta, it's just like he was a guy.
I love that you brought up Copland. What a movie.
I love that movie.
He was such a screen presence and such like a leading man, but like always having sort of like a character actor energy and like and humor. And it was just like he never despite looking the part, like he always had this like this energy that like I don't know, that was like sort of like at odds with like what a typical like Hollywood leading man would be. But like I said, like Ray Liotta as Henry Hill in Goodfellas like was a truly life-changing moment for me, just experiencing his performance in that movie and what that movie means to me and really like so many people.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, Goodfellas was like the main inspiration for Heidi World in a lot of ways, because, you know, just even starting from like the first image I had of the podcast was when the police helicopters were coming for her at the top of the Hollywood Hills, and she's all coked out of her mind, and suddenly
there's some helicopters,
like,
I'll show you some helicopters.
Yeah. Suddenly there's like 20 police dogs, you know, but also just the way Goodfellas takes a person who's like very much shades of gray and makes them, you know, the way he does it, he makes Henry Hill just like the most watchable person in a movie that also has Joe Pesci and Robert De Niro in it.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah.
Just insane. But also, yeah, I mean, I think a lot about all these Scorsese movies, especially just in terms of being able to be like, this main character is not a good person. They're not entirely a bad person, but also we're not like endorsing or condemning them. We're just telling you this story.
And
that's how I feel about Heidi Fleiss, is like, I don't want to heroize her. I'm definitely, you know, counteracting a lot of villainizing of her that was done, but the fact that she's so complicated is what makes her so interesting to me. And those are all the great characters, right?
And I guess, like, you know, obviously, like, Goodfellas is like, you know, it, one of the most iconic movies of all time. Like, you know, he never had another role that was, like, as iconic as Henry Hill. But I would just like to also recommend for anyone who has maybe never seen it, Jonathan Demme's Something Wild, which was Ray Liotta's, like, first real big breakout role that, like, led to Goodfellas. And you see him in that movie. And Something Wild is a wonderful, wonderful movie. I highly recommend it. He shows up about halfway through the movie, and it is just like from the second he is on screen, changes the entire tenor of the movie and takes it off in a completely different direction, playing a genuinely menacing, unstable, but also quite charming and handsome sociopath.
That's he's like all the guys in Heidi World are like this. It's like, there's nothing I love more than like a really funny guy who's kind of scary.
Yes, and Ray Liotta is both very funny and very scary in Something Wild. So it's a sort of an unheralded film, and not as many people talk about it like as Goodfellas, but I highly recommend Something Wild. And once again, we'd just like to extend my condolences to all of Ray Liotta's friends and families. He truly was God. Ray Liotta, may he rest in peace. Someone whose like work meant so much to me personally. So I would just like to end the show on that note and say, thank you, Molly Lambert, for joining us. The podcast is Heidi World, featuring guest appearances by Felix Biederman, among many others.
Starring Felix Biederman as Tom Sizemore.
In my opinion.
Molly, thanks so much.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for letting me talk over you guys.
That's our job. Anytime. All right. Cheers, everybody. Bye-bye.
I know I'd go from rags to riches if you would only say you care. And though my pocket may be empty, I'd be a millionaire. My clothes may still be torn and tattered.